Thank you for joining me for the next 25, 30 minutes or so as we are going to be following up on a teaching that we began last week, looking at the Church of Philippi in Revelation chapter 3. But before we do this, thank you for your support. Thank you for jumping on our website, www.myfaithchurch.org. Thank you for your contribution. You can click that donate button as well as text a contribution to 73256. We hope you're taking advantage of some of the resources that we have available for you on our website, whether it's the Right Now Media app, a Netflix type of Bible studies that are for you. You can feed yourself during the week. We hope as well that you're taking advantage of a link that will give you instructions of how to download the YouVersion Bible app as well. We actually use that quite a bit. It comes in quite handy. We send you out follow-ups from our teachings on Sunday, on Monday morning. If you would like to receive a text notification that would link you to some of those follow-ups, I encourage you to text My Faith Church, one word, to this number, 888-403-4294, right? If you were able to join us last week, I had mentioned during our time that I had an experience several years ago, and it was an experience that was humbling, you know, in many ways. I was with my youth group. I was a youth pastor at the time, and there was a missionary speaker, a lady who was probably in her late 60s or early 70s at that time, and I thought that she was going to be completely irrelevant and the kids were not going to listen to her at all. But we actually ended up being very captivated by her story. And I told that story in terms of the introduction of this particular church that we're going to be looking at last week. We're going to continue with that church in just a moment. But many of you had followed up with me and said, who was this person and how can I get her story? And so if you are interested, I just encourage you to subscribe to receiving our text alerts and that number that I had just given you, 888-403-4294. And I'm actually going to send you a link to her story. It's definitely well worth the 25 minutes or so, and you can hear firsthand basically what I heard so many years ago that captivated my attention and captivated the attention of many of my students. Well, we're going to jump in to where we left off last week. So if you didn't receive either in person the teaching from this incredible church in the book of Revelation chapter 3, the Church of Philippi, I encourage you to stop right now and actually go back and listen to that. It's right there on our YouTube page. If you're watching this, you can get to that. That was last Sunday's message, because if you're not, you're going to be kind of lost. But if you're stubborn like me, sometimes you're going to continue to watch, right? So we're going to give you just a bit of a review from where we stood last week and why we're spending so much time on this particular church. Now, we've been in this teaching series called Redefine just for a number of months now, and there's three parts to this teaching series. There's the part of redefining what it means to be great as an individual. We spent a number of weeks talking about the greatest man who ever lived according to the words of Jesus, and this was the guy by the name of John the Baptist. He didn't fit into any of those categories that we would consider would make a person a great person. He lived out in the wilderness, basically homeless, and wore animal skins and ate bugs. And yet that's not what made him great, because he was so countercultural. It was because he knew who he was, he knew what his purpose was, and he was completely controlled by the Holy Spirit, not by anything else. He wasn't controlled or possessed by his possessions. He wasn't controlled by fear. He was simply controlled by the Holy Spirit. So we spent a number of weeks looking at what it means to be an individual, a great individual. Now we're on our second part, and we've been walking through the second and third chapter in the book of Revelation. And the reason why is because our second part of our teaching series, Redefine, is focusing upon what greatness means in regard to our gatherings. And our text is the second and third chapter of the book of Revelation. And the reason why is because the Apostle John, who's an old man at this time, was banished to this island probably thought that his ministry days were behind him, and that was really Rome's desire. They just wanted John to fall, kind of fall away in the backlash, you know, at the end of his life. They didn't want to make a martyr out of him because they had made a martyr of many of the disciples by killing them. And yet, Christianity, followers of Jesus, continued to thrive, and they continued, even though they were persecuted, they continued to grow, right, in influence and in power. And so they banished John during this time when the church was incredibly facing some persecution. And John probably thought his time could be better spent going around to these various churches. But instead, God had different plans. Gives John this revelation of things that were and things that are and things that are to come. If you're familiar with Revelation, you obviously are thinking about, well, these are about the things that are to come. And it certainly is. But also, it's the things that were right there at that time. And so this book of Revelation, as John is writing it down, the best that he can as he's receiving this vision from the Lord, would originally have gone out to seven churches in what we would call modern day Turkey or Asia Minor. Seven gatherings in seven different cities. This letter would have been read out loud. And in the second and third chapter, and we've been talking about this, how when it comes to the church, the gatherings, that, you know, Jesus is the bridegroom and the church is the bride. And so beauty is in the eye of the beholder. Jesus is the one who sees clearly his church, his gatherings. He is not only the one who sees clearly, but he has the right to speak because of his sacrifice and the cost and the price that he paid for our redemption. And so he gets to define what a beautiful gathering is. And so he takes these seven churches and he basically says to them, this is what makes you beautiful. And this is what keeps you from that beauty shining through, the kind of people that I want you to be together, your gatherings. And those seven churches, some of them received nothing but compliments and kind words. And then there's some who receive nothing but rebuke and correction. And then there's others that receive a mixture of both. Well, the church that we've been on for the last week, and also we're going to continue this week, is one of those churches that most people would have just simply dismissed. In fact, Jesus describes this church, this gathering of believers in the city of Philippi, most people would have just pass them over. In fact, Jesus says about this church, I know that you have little strength. Now that probably referred to influence. It probably referred to maybe what we would call nickels and noses. You know, that's usually how we define greatness in many ways in terms of God's gatherings. But Jesus has a different definition. He has a different measuring stick, doesn't he? His measuring stick regarding his gatherings of people, his church, is to be faithful. And even though this church had little strength, little influence, you probably would have just dismissed them. And that's exactly what happened in this church. Jesus calls them great. It is a beautiful gathering of people because they are faithful. And so we're spending not just last week, but we're following up and we're redefining what it means to be great. Now, I've been spending a number of minutes over the last couple of months saying how important it is for us to understand that Jesus has a different way of looking at faithfulness or greatness, doesn't he? In fact, the more time that I spend in the Gospels alone, the more I see Jesus spending time redefining, changing people's minds, begging them, encouraging them to see things from his perspective, to see things from his point of view, to value the things that he values, because we often see differently than he does. And instead of trying to get God or Jesus to bend to our definition, which we often try to do, Jesus desires us to bend to his, because his reality is the true reality. You've heard me say this before. We don't see things the way that they are. We see things the way that we are. And so all of the scripture really as a whole is God telling us to see things the way that he sees things. You know, one of the ways that Jesus did that when he walked on this earth is that he told parables. And if you're familiar with what a parable is, it's a parallel. It's is something that Jesus takes that is common that we can understand, a story, an illustration, and he places it up against parallel, against a difficult concept, a spiritual concept, to help to explain it better. It's not to confuse us. It's meant to clarify things. But oftentimes in the telling, people would come to Jesus and they would say, why do you teach the people in parables? Why don't you just tell them, you know, what it is you want them to know? And Jesus gave a very interesting answer to that question. And I'm paraphrasing what Jesus said here. He says, there are people with eyes that don't see, and there are people with ears who don't hear. And that is why he speaks to the people in parables. What he was basically saying is this. The illustrations, the stories, the way that Jesus taught through parables reveals people's hearts. In the telling of these parables, you will see from God's perspective what he wants you to see. You can either accept that, or it's going to drive you to the other side. You're going to reject that, but you will not remain neutral when you hear the parables of Jesus. It will reveal whether or not you are teachable or not. You know, one of the sections of the scripture we have in Luke chapter 15, Jesus actually tells three parables, and they all have to deal with lost things. There's the parable of the lost sheep. There were 100 sheep, and a shepherd loses one sheep, and one sheep goes off and he searches for that sheep. And then right after that, he tells another parable about a woman who has 10 coins and she loses one of the coins, can't find it, cleans her entire house, finds it, and then throws a party, tells her friends to come and, you know, let's celebrate my coin. I found my coin, right? And then the last one is probably the one that we know the best. And that is the lost son or the prodigal son. A father has two sons. One asks for his inheritance early, squanders it, and comes back. He kills the fatted calf, right, when the son comes back. And all three of those parables teach us something about the heart of the father, what the father values. You see, when it comes down to the hard math, it just doesn't make sense. Why would a shepherd leave 99 good sheep, put them really at risk, and go out and find that one sheep that he probably could have written off as a tax credit, right? Well, why would that woman search her entire house for this kind of insurmountable coin, and in fact throw a party and probably spends more money, you know, celebrating with her friends that coin is even worth? Why would a father who has a perfectly good son at home with him who is faithful and working for him kill the fatted calf when the prodigal son, who basically told his father, I wish that you were dead, you're only good to me because of what you can give me when you're dead, why would he celebrate this? And this is why Jesus is telling these parables. Because he wants us to understand that God the Father, the heart of the Father, loves things that are lost. In fact, Jesus, the reason why he came, he says this about himself. I have not come for the healthy, I have come for the sick. And in a couple of weeks, we're going to be celebrating Easter. And that is the whole purpose and reason why Jesus came. And Jesus describes this, the heart of the Father, the reason and the purpose why he came. We're all sick, right? We all have a spiritual heart disease. And only those who understand that and realize that will see the heart of the Father and respond to the Son that was sent. So we get to celebrate that together in just a few weeks with Easter. If you don't have a church home, we encourage you, if you are able to come and join us at 10 o'clock, we're going to be opening another section of the building. The sanctuary is full. We're going to stream that in. And so you can actually sit and you can participate at a table, right? You don't have to go in with the rest of us. There's going to be room for everybody. So we hope that you will join us. Well, we're going to jump back into our teaching series, looking at this church in Philippi. And just to refresh our memory, I'm going to read the scripture once again. Here we go. This is in the third chapter of the book of Revelation. I'll be starting in verse 7. Here's what it says. This is what Jesus says to this church. To the angel of the church of Philippi write, these are the words of him who is holy and true, who holds the key of David. What he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open. I know your deeds. See, I have placed before you an open door that no one can shut. I know that you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. I will make those who are the synagogue of Satan, who claim to be Jews, though that they are not, but are liars. I will make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I have loved you. Now that's as far as we got last week. This idea of open and shut doors, this idea of being excluded, and those who have excluded you, they will come and they will acknowledge who you are. What does that mean? Well, if you were able to be with us last week, we talked in detail what that meant. See, during this time, Jews would often open their doors to followers of Jesus because they shared a common background. And at the first and at the front, they really considered Christians or Jesus followers just basically a sect of Judaism. And so, come on, we'll celebrate our feast and our festivals. Of course, you have Jewish background. Yeah, Jesus was a Jew. Come and celebrate, you know, our holidays with us. But the problem was, these early Christians, especially in this city, they refused to stop talking about the resurrection. And that rubbed them the wrong way. You know, if you were a part of, your name was in the synagogues, you were actually exempt from saying, Caesar is Lord. And so they were kicked out, these Christians, because they refused to give up the central fulcrum of their faith, the resurrected Jesus. They did not deny that. And in their exclusion, and even though they didn't have this political protection anymore, they were going to be not forced because they didn't bend, but they no longer were exempt from saying Caesar is Lord. So they were facing persecution, not only by the Jews that had kicked them out, and that is such a big deal if you were a Jewish person, because if you were kicked out from the fellowship, that really meant that you were separated from God. This is what the Jews were saying to those early followers of Jesus in this city in particular. Your name was erased. The doors were shut. You were excluded. You did not have that political protection anymore. And Jesus is complimenting this gathering of believers in this church because, yes, they had little strength, but they refused to deny the resurrected Jesus. And even though Jesus says you have little strength, you are strong, right? And in their exclusion, they found their identity. They found their identity in Christ. You know, our identity in Christ is simply this: Jesus and Jesus alone gets to define who we are. He gets to define who we are, not our feelings, not our past, not anyone else, not the culture. Jesus tells us who we are. And so if he says that we are a new creation, that we're dead to sin, that we're alive to Christ, that the old is gone and the new has come, despite of what we feel, despite of what our past is, despite of what other people have to say, we know that that is true. He defines our values, our ethics, and our morals as well. He gets to define who we are. And in this difficulty, this church found, in their exclusion, they found out a stronger understanding of who they were. And we talked about that last week at great length. But that's not all that Jesus has to say about this incredible church. So we're going to move on. Just a couple things real quickly, as our time is quickly diminishing. A couple more observations. I spent a little more time than I should have in terms of reviewing, but I wanted you to understand the context. Here's the second observation that we see from this church. It's number two. This church suffered with patient endurance and received promised protection. Here's one of the verses that is one of perhaps the most controversial verses actually in the entire book of Revelation, and it has to do with this church. It says this: since you have kept my command to endure patiently, comma, and here's the second part of this verse, I will also keep you from the hour of trial that is going to come upon the whole world to test the inhabitants of this world. Now, the reason why this verse is so controversial is because the second half of this verse. Many people look at the second half of this verse, that this church will be exempt from this hour of trial that's going to come on the whole world, and they take this as, well, this is referring to the tribulation. This is referring to that seven-year period of time where the Antichrist is going to reveal himself later on, and it's going to be a miserable time. This is saying that this is the faithful. This is God's church, big C. And because you're faithful, Jesus is going to come down and rapture his church. before the tribulation, going to keep the church from this hour of trial. Now, some people would say that's what this second half of this verse means. While there are others who would say, that's not about this. All these other things that have been talked about is about this particular church, not the church in general. So why are we thinking that this is a general statement? Maybe it's just about something about this particular church. And there were certainly persecutions that came over, you know, the church during this time. And so this is just talking about this church being exempt. Now, I would actually fall into that category. It doesn't mean that the rapture is not going to happen. I mean, the rapture is going to happen. It's not really making even a statement that Jesus comes before or after the seven-year tribulation, right? It's just not relevant to this church. I would actually fall into that category. That is why this verse is so controversial. But sometimes we, in the controversy, we forget the command. Because the important part of this verse is not the controversial part. The important part of this verse is the first part of this verse, where it says this, since you have kept my command to endure patiently. The second part is just, you know, yeah, you're going to be kept from this hour of trial. And whether it was this church in particular, or whether this is a statement for, you know, the general statement for the faithful, we're not really sure, right? But the first part of this verse, you have kept my command and you have endured patiently. What does that mean, to endure patiently? Well, to endure patiently means to be obedient, to be faithful, even when you can't see, even when you can't figure out, even when you can't dissect how God is going to intervene in your situation. You continue to be faithful. You continue to be obedient, even though you can't figure it out. You don't see how God is going to be able to work the situation out. You don't see how God is going to intervene. You just continue to be faithful. That's the important part about this verse. You see, sometimes we get it backwards, don't we? We think, I will be faithful and I will be obedient when you tell me how it's all going to work out, and you give me the directions, you give me the step-by-step of how, God, you are going to intervene, how you're going to work this whole situation out, how you are going to plan this thing out, and just give me the steps, give me the plan, and I will be obedient. If you just tell me, if I can just figure it out, how, God, you're going to do this, then I can see, and then I can obey. But that's not how God works. God says this, and it's, I can give you so many examples in the scripture. It is not first see, then obey. It is obey, then you see. There are so many examples in the Bible of people who have gotten this backwards. A great example would be Jacob. If you're familiar with the story of Jacob, Jacob was the younger of his twin brother Esau. God had actually said, and Jacob would have known this, that the older will serve the younger, and the blessing and the promises will go to the descendants of Jacob. Jacob is the one to be blessed. And Jacob understood this, and Jacob knew this. And yet, Jacob's father, Isaac, favored his brother Esau, was going to give him the blessing. And we see Jacob on a number of occasions helping God out, because he doesn't see how God is going to work it out. And so Jacob manipulates his brother to receive a birthright, and then he deceives his father, dressing up like his brother Esau. And in his haste to force God's hand, he actually delays the promise even more. See, Jacob had a problem that oftentimes we share as well. We don't think God is fast enough, and because we don't see how God is going to intervene, we think that we'll just help him out a little bit instead of patiently enduring. You see, Jacob could have learned some lessons from his grandfather, Abraham. Abraham had this command that was given to him. I want you to take your son, Isaac, Jacob's father, Isaac, and I want you to sacrifice him. And what did Abraham do? Well, the scripture says early the next morning, he didn't wait, he didn't delay. Early the next morning, he sets out. He brings the fire, he brings the wood, he brings everything. Abraham did not know how that whole thing was going to work out, how that whole thing was going to play out. He didn't know that God was going to stop him at the last moment. He didn't know that this was going to be a story that many people from history, it points to Jesus and the significance of what that story is about, that even though God was willing to stop Abraham's hand into sacrificing his son, it was a pointer to Jesus. The Father was willing to sacrifice his one and only son, Jesus. You know, in Abraham's story, Abraham's hand was stopped, and yet there was a substitute ram that was used for the sacrifice. And we see that's a big giant pointer. All of that story is so significant, but Abraham had no idea at that time what was going on, but he still was faithful. He patiently endured. Jacob could have learned something from his grandfather, and I'm sure he knew that story. This church was persecuted. This church had been mistreated. This church's gathering of believers had been excommunicated from the synagogue. Their names had been erased. They had no idea how God was going to work it out. They just simply trusted that God was going to work it out. And this is what Jesus said: I will keep you from that hour of trial. You know, there's a number of ways that God can intervene. God can keep you from a circumstance, and he certainly did that in this particular church. God can walk through with you through a circumstance. We know that this is the case with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in Daniel chapter 3. They refused to bow down to a false god. They were thrown into the furnace. And when King Nebuchadnezzar looked in, right, and his executioners, and they saw four who were in the furnace. And that was an Old Testament appearance of Jesus. It's called a Christophany, right? Jesus can walk through with you in the fire. And when they came out, not even their clothes smelled from the fire. And then Jesus can also use a circumstance to ultimately deliver you. In fact, that's what happened with John the Baptist. John the Baptist lost his head, but yet, as the Apostle Paul said, absent from the body, present with the Lord. The Apostle Paul understood this. Do not be afraid of those who can kill the body, but be afraid of those who can take your soul, right? The idea is that absent from the body, present with the Lord. And Paul understood this. I will go on doing what God has called me to do. And if God calls me home, then either way I win. That was Paul's attitude. So God will intervene in your situation. He can keep you from the circumstance. He can walk with you through the circumstance. Or he can ultimately use that circumstance to ultimately deliver you home in victory. Now for this particular church, here is the command. And it's the command for us too. Be patient. Patiently endure, because one of those three options are going to occur. This church was faithful, and this church obeyed, had faithful, patient endurance, and God kept them from the circumstance. Here's the last observation that we have. This church was faithful with little, and God gave them more. Notice what the scripture says. This scripture says this: I know that you have little strength, and yet you have kept my word, and you have not denied my name. You had little, and now because of your faithfulness, I will give you more. Notice what he says at the end of this address to this church. The one who is victorious, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. You see, you are kicked out of the synagogue. Now you're going to be a pillar in my temple. You don't move pillars. Pillars are there. Pillars you cannot move. They're foundational to the structure. Never again will they leave it. You are kicked out. You're never going to leave my temple. Your names were erased from the synagogue. Your name will not be erased. In fact, this is what Jesus says: I will write on them the name of my God. You will have my name written on you, and the name of the city of my God. Yes, you live in Philippi, where there's a lot of corruption, and they're kicking you out. That's a worldly city. But in my city, the new Jerusalem, all things will be made new, which is coming down out of heaven from my God. And I will also write on them my new name. You will experience Jesus in a whole new way. Because you were faithful with little, I will give you more. You know, Jesus told a parable about this, didn't he? It's the parable of the talents, which is just a measurement of money. There was one servant. There's a master gathered three servants before he went on a journey. One servant, he gave five talents. Another one, he gave two. And the last servant, he gave one. And he says, here's what I'm giving you, I'm entrusting you with this. Then he goes off on a journey, and after a long time, the scripture says he comes back, calls his servants together. The one who had five had made five more. He has 10. Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into your reward, right? The one who had two doubled it as well, and now he has four. Well done, good and faithful servant, right? The last one buried his talent, presented it before his master, and his master said, and by the way, this is in Matthew chapter 25, in the context of the end times. He says, you wicked and lazy servant, you squandered it. You did nothing. You just buried it. You should have at least put it on with the bankers and received some interest. Now, the parables are meant to be discussed, right? They're meant to be evaluated. Maybe perhaps the one who was given one said, well, guess what? This is insignificant. If he thinks that this is all that I'm worth, all that I can be entrusted, well, guess what? You get what you pay for. I'm just going to bury it. I'm not going to work, right? I'm not even going to be faithful with what little he has given me. What a wrong attitude, right? You see, there are no small jobs in the kingdom of God. You see, the principle here is this. When you are faithful with little, God will give you more. We see this with Joseph, don't we? We talked about Joseph in detail last week. He was faithful as a slave in Potiphar's household. He was the same person in Potiphar's household as he was in the palace with Pharaoh. God rewarded him by giving him more power and influence. See, oftentimes we want to jump right into the big things, don't we? We say, you know what, I want to do something big for God's kingdom, but maybe perhaps it starts with doing something that is small. If you want to change the world, maybe first start cleaning your room, right? I kind of tell that to my 16-year-old here now, as he had a birthday yesterday, right? There are no small jobs in the kingdom of God. And this church was faithful with what little that they had. And look what God says. He says, now you're going to be a pillar in my temple. I'm going to write my name on you. And guess what? You're never going to leave. You're going to be one who has a place of prominence because you were faithful with little. And our takeaway, our challenge is this. This is how this address ends. He says, whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. May we truly do that, because all of us, me, myself included, we need a redefinition of what it means to be great. Oh, the Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. May his face shine upon you, give you strength until we meet again. God bless.